Hello! In this video, I'll show you how to blink multiple LEDs in a pattern. This is not your run-of-the-mill blink LED tutorial, but something a lot more interesting. Blinking a single LED has been done to death, and it's just so boring. After watching this video, you'll be able to do something like this, and all without loops. So let's get started. Here's what you need for this project. You need a breadboard with a cobbler connector. You need some LEDs. Any color will do, any standard LEDs. They don't even have to be the same color, it's up to you. You need some resistors, one resistor per LED. 220 or 330 ohms would be ideal. You can go a little higher, up to 1K. I would not suggest going lower because then you're running into risk of your LEDs drawing too much current from the GPIO. You also need a jumper wire or a flat wire to connect the ground. I prefer the flat wires, but if you don't have them, one of these will do as well. It's entirely up to you. And of course, you need the Raspberry Pi. Let's start with the basic circuit build. We will be using those simple components, which you just seen, to complete three separate LED circuits connected to different GPIO ports. Have a look at the circuit diagram. The pins used in this particular tutorial are number 13, 19, and 26. This is BCM numbering, consistent with what you see on a cobbler, and what by default is used in Python programs. If you're unfamiliar with the cobbler connector, I suggest you have a look at my video that will show you how to use this. I prefer that over loose jumper wires. You take one of the resistors, bend the legs, and connect it to the breadboard. Let's say we'll start with number 26. Let's see how far this will get us. So that might be a good spot for connecting the LED. The LED has two different legs. The longer one is the plus side, the anode. That's the one that goes towards the GPIO. We can avoid using additional jumper wires by going straight from the row here to the ground rail. That's almost the circuit. What's still missing is the ground. You can use this particular connection to ground or any other available which is more convenient. As we'll be connecting more resistors here, that particular connection to the ground here may get in the way, so perhaps we can use this one and keep the ground out of the way. So that completes the first circuit. The GPIO will provide power. Electricity will flow through the resistor, through the LED, lighting it up, returning to the ground, back to the Raspberry Pi. And we need to do this two more times for pin 19 and 13. So here's the completed circuitry. Things to watch out for. Make sure that none of these wires here touch each other and that the LEDs are connected with the right polarity with the same longer legs on this side. Notice that I didn't use any additional jumper wires. We're trying to keep it simple. Every time you can eliminate some wires, that's always good. Because I plugged in the ground connectors of the LED straight to the power rail, I didn't have to use three separate jumpers here.
The next step is completed on your PC. If you have your Raspberry Pi connected to a monitor and keyboard, this might be slightly different than what I have. My Raspberry Pi is connected just to power and Wi-Fi, and it is running headless. For that to work, you need two terminal windows, or two PuTTY windows, essentially two connections. Whatever your situation, I recommend using just the terminal, even if graphical editors are available to you. you will learn a lot more about the Raspberry Pi environment that way. I sized my terminal windows differently. The terminal on the left will be my main area for editing code, while the other one will be used to test and control the program. This way, I do not have to constantly exit the editor, and I can see my code at all times. It's up to you which editor you use. If you are a beginner, I suggest using Nano. To create or edit a text file with Nano, you use the Nano program name with the file you want to work with, for example, leds.py. Nano Editor is easy to use. All you need to learn is a couple of keyboard shortcuts shown on the bottom help bar. The caret symbol represents the control key, and all keyboard shortcuts are activated using that key. For example, to exit the program, press Ctrl X, and that will take you back to the terminal prompt. If you have unsaved changes, Nano will allow you to save changes before exiting. Let's add some text and see how that works. Python programs are started with the following line: !usr/bin/python3. This has to be the first line in the file, and there cannot be anything before that, not even a blank line or a space. This special line tells the Pi which programming language is used in the code that follows. Look at the help bar. The write-out shortcut is Ctrl-O. If you want to save the file without exiting, you can use the appropriate keyboard shortcut to write out. Nano will ask you to confirm the file name. You can save it under new file name or keep the old one. Press Enter to save, and you can keep working. If you continue writing a program and press Ctrl X at some point, Nano will allow you to save or abandon changes before exiting. Say Y for yes, and then confirm the file name. If you choose to use Nano, I suggest optimizing it for Python coding. For that, you need to create a file called .nanorc. The dot indicates the file is hidden. The nanorc file is the startup and configuration file for the Nano editor. Here's my configuration. Please note that the line numbers are not stored in the file, just displayed. These four settings should be sufficient for basic Python program editing. After setting this up, your Nano will display line numbers. It will continue multi-line indentation, and it will set the indentation to 4 spaces, which is standard Python coding practice. The last setting will convert tab presses to 4 spaces, which is also part of Python coding standards, where tabs are discouraged. Nano is great for beginners, but if you have other preference, my recommendation is to stay away from graphical tools until you learn more. I prefer to use an advanced editor called VI. Certainly, if you at some point would like to add the word Linux to your resume, learning the VI editor is a requirement. Let's continue with our program. The default libraries available with Python do not have necessary functionality to support the GPIO. For that, you need to import an additional library of your choice, as there are several. The one I recommend is called GPIO0. It is very simple to use and makes programming Python with Raspberry Pi very easy. I suggest importing only the portions of the GPIO0 library, just what you need, instead of the whole thing. This will make your program simpler and easier to read. The class that we will be using in this tutorial is called LED. Once imported, it can be used in the program to create instances of the LED class. You need to specify the GPIO pin for each LED instance, and each LED needs a unique name. Remember, Python code is case sensitive. Let's create the first LED object connected to the pin 13. Very similar syntax is used for the remaining two LEDs, remembering where they are connected on the breadboard. We should test the circuit to make sure that everything is connected properly. The basic syntax is to simply turn all LEDs on. Each LED is operated separately, and they work independently of each other. Using this syntax, all three LEDs will light up. This program will execute top to bottom and not stop after lighting up a specific LED. To our human eye, that will look as if they all lit up at the same time, which is what we want. At the same time, the program will keep going after the LEDs are lit, and in this case, we don't have anything after this, which means the program will end right away, and we will not even see the LEDs on. To avoid this, we need to pause the program after the LEDs are activated. For that, we need additional import. It is important to know that pause does not have a duration set. A pause program will be stuck until it receives a signal which will move the program in a different direction. For us, this signal will be the keyboard interrupt by pressing the Control C key sequence. Let's save the program. This should be sufficient to get us started. We will run the program in the other terminal window, but before that happens, we need to connect the Raspberry Pi.
As you see right here, my breadboard is disconnected. I wrote my program, I double-checked my circuit, so now I can connect my Raspberry Pi. You should always build your circuit or make any changes to this with the Raspberry Pi disconnected. Only when you are sure that this is all done correctly, then you connect your Raspberry Pi. So now my Pi is connected, I can try running the program.
Now there's different ways to run your Python programs on Raspberry Pi. Very often in tutorials, the syntax is just Python and the name of your program, for example, LEDs.py. That's relatively simple, but there's two issues with it that I have. For once, when you just say Python, you're invoking Python version 2, which at this point in time is deprecated. You should not be using it anymore unless you have a good reason. Today, we're using Python 3, so at the very least, you invoke Python 3 through that. What this command means, when you press enter, Python 3 interpreter will run the program which we just wrote. While this works, I'm not a big fan of this method because this makes your life a little harder in the future in terms of process control and other things. I would say, let's do this properly. Your program, LEDs.py, is a standalone program. It only needs proper permissions. If we look at the file right now, with the ls command, you'll see that by default, I can read and write the program, which means I can view it, I can also change it, create it. But what's missing for that to be a proper program is the execute permission. That's not happening by default. Let's add it. Here's the command that will do this for us. chmod u plus x. This means for the user, myself, I wish to add execute permissions for the file name. Now, if we look at the permissions, you'll see that the execute flag is there, rwx, and also notice the output here, change the color to green. That's an additional hint. To run a program like that, we use the .slash syntax. This means the file is in my present working directory and the file name. Once you do this, you simply press enter. You'll notice that all three LEDs lit up. That's good, means everything was connected correctly. The program will sit like this right now. The pause takes an effect. This will be like this until you turn off the power or terminate the program. To terminate the program, we press Control C. Control C terminates the program. And in case of GPIO 0, simple controls such as LEDs also get turned off. So if we look at the circuit board, the LEDs are no longer lit up. This is what you want. You never want to have your programs exit with the circuits energized. The only thing to address here is this bit of output here. Python by default will show you a traceback message. That's diagnostic. This is not an error, it's simply diagnostic. And it tells you what the program was doing just before it ended, and also what happened when the program ended. I personally like to turn it off, and I suggest that you do the same. Very small change to the program. This is handled through exceptions. You need to add three lines of code, try and accept and pass. And you also need to move some code around. Python programs are formatted through spaces. Here we use four spaces. So whatever code you had before, we need to move it to the right by four spaces. This tells the computer that whatever you see here belongs under the try block. Similarly, the way the pass belongs under the keyboard interrupt exception handler. All I want you to get out of here is essentially the try block here marks a section of the code when something may happen during runtime. In our case, we will press the Control C key sequence. And what that does is sends a signal to the program called keyboard interrupt. And in this case, we say, all right, if you get that signal, do what? Pass means do nothing. Before, we didn't tell the program how to behave, so some default functionality kicked in. Now we actually do tell the program what to do. This will not change the program in terms that it works. I can still go back and run it. The LED is lit up as before, but now when I press Control C, there's nice, clean exit, no more diagnostic messages, especially if you're writing programs for other people. Certainly you don't want to scare them with something and have them see and then wonder whether something is wrong. All of my examples, all my tutorials will use this basic syntax when the basic functionality of your program will be under one big try block, and then I'll have at least a keyboard interrupt. There may be something here a bit more specific. In some cases, you may need to have some code, close GPIO pins or spin down motors or anything like that. In this case, this is very simple. Pass means do nothing, and that means the program ends. The blinking action essentially comes down to turning LEDs on, waiting for a little bit, and turning them off. That can be accomplished in different ways. A lot of tutorials, they use loops. There isn't really a need for loops unless you're blinking some complex patterns or many, many LEDs. In case of 1, 2, or 3 LEDs, certainly loops are not required, especially with the GPIO 0, which handles that very nicely. So what turns out is the LED class has a method called blink. And that's exactly what we will use right here. So instead of on, we will replace it with blink for all of them. Let's see how this changes what happens on the breadboard. Save the changes and execute the program again. So notice now they all blink in unison. The default interval for GPIO 0 LED blink is 1 second on, 1 second off. Because we started them at the same time, they'll blink at the same time. And that again will go on forever until you end the program. What we want is something a little bit more sophisticated. What we will do here is blinking pattern, sort of a traveling light when we go across multiple LEDs. For that, we will need to introduce some sort of brief sleep period. So that's the method which we'll use. But before that happens, let's work it out on a graph paper, what that would look like. If we were to draw the timings for our LEDs, so this is second 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. We can draw the LED 1 and LED 2 and LED 3 cycles. So the first one comes on, and what we want here is the second one to come on, and afterwards the third one to come on, and then we want to repeat it. So the first one come on again, second one, third one, and so on. Repeating pattern. The nice thing about working with paper here is that it's easy to visualize and shape it the way you want. So it's easy to see that there's 1 second here and 2 seconds here. 1 second here and 2 seconds here, and so on. These are the same. So in other words, LED is on for 1 second and off for 2 seconds, on for 1 second, off for 2 seconds. And the only challenge here is at the beginning, we need to figure out how to time the startups. We start the first one, and when this one turns off after 1 second, we start the second one. When this one turns off, we start the third one. So in other words, there's 1 second sleep here and 2 seconds here as well. Once you get them started, they all will sync. You don't have to worry about it. You just need to get them going in the right way. So let's change the code and see how that would work. The function used to introduce a little delay into the program execution is called sleep. We import it from the time library. A few changes that need to be made to our code. First of all, we need to introduce the delays. So after the first LED starts blinking, we'll sleep for 1 second. This delays both LED 2 and LED 3 blinking by 1 second. But we still need the second delay of 1 second before we delay the third LED blink. Why not 2 here? Because this delay here is included right here. Let's test it. Let's see what this looks like after those changes. Save the changes and run our program. Well, not quite what we wanted. They do have a pattern, but it's not traveling from left to right the way it was intended. So what happens here, we forgot to do one thing. If we look at the intervals, the LED is supposed to be on for 1 second and off for 2 seconds. All three are the same. Well, we haven't changed the code. We left it at default because for now, the LEDs blink as if we had two parameters such as 1.1. So this strict syntax means LED blinks for 1 second and turns off for 1 second. That's the default. This is why we didn't have to provide it. If you wish to change it, we do need to provide the number. So the change required here is this. That tells LED 1 to turn on for 1 second and then turn off for 2 seconds and then continue that as a cycle. The same change here. That should be sufficient. Let's give it a try. Save changes. There you go. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, please subscribe and I'll make more.